copy of the slides. And yes. So we're getting, it's 8 o'clock here, 8:02, and we now have 15 people on the line. And I know that we'll continue to get a few more. But we just want to welcome everybody. As you're getting on, we are getting ready to hear Dr. Jeff Ryder, and Kim Schuler and I are on, and working through some of the, just the mechanics of getting everybody on and getting your phones or your microphones muted if you can. We definitely can have a chance for some conversation if needed, and we'll have the chat box open if you want to type in questions or comments. And if you would, go ahead and type in your name and your what your role is in whatever organization or location, so that we'll be able to keep track of that. Because part of the purpose of this meeting, this is our actual third time for this meeting. And Jeff, I don't know if you know, this is a new organization that we have formed out of our CPC Plus stakeholder group. And going to CFHA and meeting Gen Y and hearing some of you national experts, and then going to IBIN. ABIN is forming around a model after IBIN. And we now have our 501(c)(3) status as a nonprofit. We have a board of directors, and we are trying to, our mission and purpose is to create a place for training, education, and networking to provide implementation of behavioral health in medical settings. And so we're exploring how that's going to work in Arkansas, and then connecting, you know, around the country. So we really appreciate you being on board, Jeff. And we also appreciate everybody's input, because what ABIN is going to be is what the people here want it to be. You know, we have some great models out there. So, Kim, is there anything that you would like to say before we get Jeff to introduce himself and tell who he is and what his role is?
No, that was a wonderful introduction. Thank you, Dr. Gibson. We're excited for today's call, and I'm going to hand it over to you, Jeff.
Okay, wonderful. Well, thanks so much for the invitation to be here. Yeah, I've been hearing, it's good to hear a little more detail about exactly what your group is up to right now. I knew that this was something that has been kind of percolating for a little while there in Arkansas, just from, you know, what I've heard from you, Patty. So, but sounds like things are moving along swimmingly there. So that's fantastic. And yeah, just very, very pleased that you invited me to be a part of this today. So I'm Jeff Ryder. I'm a psychologist. I've been doing integrated primary care for, I don't know, probably about 18 years now, something like that. I started off, I was running an integrated primary care service in the community health sector in Seattle. I did that for many, many years. Then I moved to the commercial, you know, fee-for-service sector. Did the same thing there, ran an integrated primary care service, a Swedish medical group, again in Seattle. Now I'm with the federal government, so I've kind of been in all three sectors there of the primary care system, the community health sector, fee-for-service, and now in the federal government. I'm working with the Department of Defense, helping them in their rollout of integrated primary care across the military healthcare system. So we have about 250 or so behavioral health consultants in primary care on military bases around the world. So I've also written a couple books about this, what we're going to talk about today, the primary care behavioral health model, which is one particular model of integrating behavioral health into primary care. I think with that, we should probably just launch into it then. So one thing I will say about myself is that that I didn't mention is that I have actually spent the majority of my career in the clinic too. Most of my time actually has been spent providing direct patient care. I like to mention that because as a clinician, which I know many of you are, You know, I was never really super enthusiastic about people who aren't actually doing the clinical work coming in and trying to tell us how to do clinical work, especially if it's different or maybe even a little bit harder than what we've done in the past. So suffice to say, you know, what I'm talking about today is not going to be theoretical. It's going to be pragmatic and all about how to make this work on the front lines, which so many of you are. So let's jump into the slides here and see if I can get this to work. Okay. All right, so we'll talk a little bit first about, I'm not gonna spend a lot of time on this first one, understanding the need for integrated care. I think many of you probably have already kind of a feel for why integrated care is happening, but I do wanna review just some basics of why integration of behavioral health into primary care is happening, because making sure that we all are kind of aware of all the factors that are spurring integration forward is a big part of understanding how do we want to integrate then when we do integrate. So we'll do at least a brief review there of why we are integrating behavioral health into primary care. Then I'll go through the approaches that have developed over time to integrating behavioral health into primary care. And then we'll focus more specifically on this primary care behavioral health or PCBH model. after we get through that, we will talk about what I call the landmines and the trampolines. So the landmines are clinical and operational practices that you want to avoid, right? Because if you do them, they're going to blow up your service and not in a good way. But the trampolines are the clinical and operational practices that you want to embrace, because if you're doing these things, it's likely to propel your service and really grow it. Okay, so and then I've got some slides at the end too that contain references. I'm obviously not going to go through all those, but they're just there for your reference. Okay, so. And then as we go along, feel free really to, I've got a lot of content and I'm going to kind of be just keeping up a steady pace here, but feel free to interrupt, take yourself off mute and jump in if you have a question or put something in the chat box. I'll try to monitor the chat box over here. I've got it up on my screen. If you have a question or a comment. So in terms of just understanding why integration of behavioral health into primary care is occurring, this first slide here with the pie chart tells a lot of the story. Okay, so what this chart shows is that it shows what happens to people in the United States who have a diagnosed mental health or substance abuse problem, okay, in terms of what kind of care do they get, right? So there are, depending on which epidemiological survey you believe, somewhere around a quarter to a third of the US population during a given year will have a psychiatric diagnosis of some sort, right? So that's a lot of people. 25 to 33% have of the US population in a given year would meet criteria for a DSM diagnosis. So what happens to them in terms of their care? So what this chart shows is that the vast majority, are around about 60%, don't get any care at all, right? They might talk to their, you know, to their barber, to their priest or something like that, but they're not seeking any kind of formal treatment for their diagnosable problem. We'll come back to that group in a minute though, because there's an important thing to know about them. The blue part here and the red part show how care is divvied up amongst people who do seek care. So amongst people who do seek some kind of formal treatment for their problem, just a tad more than half will go to primary care. Primary care providers prescribe around about 85% of the antidepressants in the country, about two-thirds of all psychotropics medication in the country. So there's a huge amount of prescribing that's going on in primary care, and just a huge amount of direct care delivery for mental health problems. But in addition to the people who are seeking care directly in primary care, we know there's so much of that. We go back to this group in the green, the 59%, what we know about them is that they may not be seeking care directly for their mental health problem, but in all likelihood, they're going to primary care for something. at some point during the course of a given year. Because around about 80% of the population goes to primary care for something. It might just be for a sore throat or a physical for work or something like that. But the vast majority of people will enter primary care for something during the course of a given year. So the message there is, if we can do better at identifying when those folks come into primary care, identifying that they have a diagnosable disorder and getting some care to them, we can maybe go a long way towards getting help to people who otherwise don't get it, okay? So, you know, think about why don't people go to specialty mental health? I mean, why is it that so many people go to their primary care doctor instead of going to a therapist or a psychiatrist? Or why do so many people, 60% of people, not seek any care at all? Well, you know, I mean, a lot of the reasons are familiar to you, I'm sure. There's stigma, right? Lack of insurance, lack of resources. People might not have, you know, a lot of people might not have transportation to get to regular therapy appointments or childcare, you know, to allow them to go out for regular therapy appointments and so forth. Many patients, of course, view their problem as physical. You know, I've got pain or I've got fatigue or something like that. You know, I don't have depression. I don't have stress, right? It feels like a physical problem to me, so I'm just going to go to my physical doctor. But inconvenience is also a big part of this. And I don't know if inconvenience is the best term, but it sort of captures what I'm talking about here. But there can be, I'm sure many of you know, a really, really long wait for people to get in to see specialty mental health services. This is just across the board. It can be a really, really long wait to get in for them. And, you know, most people, I don't know about you, but when I'm feeling like I've got a health issue that needs to be addressed, I want it addressed now. I don't want to wait 6 weeks and then, you know, 6 weeks from now, go in, have an intake appointment, which really is just kind of collecting some, you know, basic information about me. And then 2 to 3 weeks later, coming back to start the real work, you know, that's, you know, most people want help a little bit more promptly than that. And so they just turn to the easiest way to get it, and that is going to their primary care doctor. And of course, people also have a lot more familiarity with their primary care, you know, clinic and provider. And many times they've gone there for a long time, and maybe their kids go there, their neighbors go there, they know how to get there, they know where to park, you know, they know the bus route, that sort of a thing. So it's just, you know, it's easy, it's easier. Sometimes people have had negative experiences with the mental health system that deter them. We hear about this all the time when we're talking to people in primary care. And then there's also therapists impose limits on scope, right? So so part of the access problem in especially mental health is that people specialize, right? So, you know, yes, I can help you with your PTSD, but not until you get that alcohol treatment or alcohol problem under control, right? So, you know, we kind of really carve out niches for ourselves, and especially mental health, and that makes it just all the more difficult for people to access us then, in especially mental health. So very, very few people actually, as a result of all this, end up actually going to mental health when they're referred. The data, if you look at studies out there, say about 20% of patients referred from primary care will actually follow through on a diagnosis or on a referral to specialty mental health. I can tell you in the real world, not the world of journals, but the real world, it feels like a lot less than 20% actually go. A lot of you have probably experienced that too. So we have, you know, an access problem with the specialty mental health care system that is driven by so many different factors. All that just pushes people to either seek no help at all or just go to what's easiest for them, which is primary care. So that's one issue then that is driving integration, right, is this access problem and the need to the fact that there are so many patients who are already getting care in primary care. So we want to have more people on board the primary care team to help out with that. It's also important to remember that there are so many people who have behavioral issues, that show up in other ways, affecting their health in other ways, right? So chronic disease management, fastest growing part of primary care, and yet, you know, the vast majority of people with chronic diseases don't manage them well, right? So diabetes, hypertension, things like that. A lot of this, you know, the keys to success of to successful management of these services involves lifestyle and behavior change, right? And these are challenges that the primary care providers talk to their patients about every day, okay? How to change their diet, exercise more, quit smoking, and so forth in order to better manage their chronic diseases. Somatic complaints with the lifestyle and the stress component. These are problems like chronic pain, chronic fatigue, obesity we could put into that category. Subthreshold problems. These are problems that aren't necessarily psychiatric diagnoses. They don't meet the threshold of psychiatric diagnosis, but they are definitely problems, psychosocial problems that consume a lot of time and energy in primary care. So I'm talking about things like domestic violence, marital problems, child behavior problems, bereavement. People talk about these things with their PCPs every day. And there's preventive health, right? All the ways that primary care providers attempt to counsel their patients to change their behaviors and their lifestyle in order to prevent health problems from occurring. And primary care providers talk about these problems and these challenges with patients from, you know, infancy through older adults, right? They it's the birth to death longitudinal care they provide, and it's really all manner of psychiatric and substance abuse problems that they deal with. So there's just a huge variety in the ways that that behavior shows up in health that primary care providers manage and work with patients on day in and day out. I'm going to skip this next slide. You can watch it later if you like. This is an old colleague of mine, primary care doctor at Swedish. I asked him one day to look over his schedule and identify patients who he thought were going to have a significant behavioral issue that they were coming in with today that was affecting their health. We're going to skip that because I couldn't get the video to work right last night. But it's maybe there for you to use later. Couple last slides here on why to integrate this third factor is economic factors, right? So we know that patients with psychosocial issues utilize care a lot more. Psychosocial factors really drive the majority of visits, and people with psychiatric disorders utilize about 50% more physical health services. So this slide here, this is a Milliman analysis that was done for the American Psychiatric Association a few years ago. I think this data might be a tad old, like they might have updated it in the last year or two, but you know, nonetheless, the point stands that what this slide shows is how much it costs to care for people with various diagnoses if they have and if they don't have a psychiatric comorbidity, right? And the takeaway here is that if you look in the far right column, it costs probably on average around about 200% more to care for people with these various, you know, common chronic medical conditions if there is an additional psychiatric comorbidity in place. So there's a real economic argument here for integration in the sense that if we can do better in primary care with identifying people who have psychiatric issues and getting more and better care to those folks, then we can potentially reduce the cost of caring for a whole lot of other problems, okay? And then finally, last reason for integrating is that it's really, really hard for primary care providers to do this stuff alone. They have very little time with patients. Most patients come in with multiple complaints and concerns that they would like addressed. These primary care providers often haven't gotten a whole lot of training in behavior change strategies their residencies. And they have a ton of administrative tasks to do. There was one study in the New England Journal of Medicine a few years ago that showed that on average, primary care providers have 36 urgent but unpaid tasks every day that they do in addition to seeing their 20 or 25 patients, right? So these are things like calling a specialist back, talking through a case with them, refilling medications, you know, ordering an x-ray, you know, things like this. They would need, a couple studies showed, primary care providers would need 7.5 hours extra per day if they were doing all of the preventive care that they are supposed to be doing, according to the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force. And they would need 10 hours per day in order to do all the chronic care that they are supposed to be doing. So they're just faced with an impossible task, really. And so it's no great surprise that primary care is the most overworked and underpaid part of the healthcare system. It's a stressed part of the healthcare system. And so what we're trying to do with integration here is to be there to help, all right? So just to recap, integration is occurring because of a few different factors here. There's the high volume of patients who are seeking care in primary care. There is the frequent intersection of behavioral health, all the different ways that behavior shows up in the health concerns that PCPs manage every day. There's an economic argument. And then there's the fact that primary care is really, really overly burdened, and they could use help with managing everything that's coming on their lap every day. Okay, so having gone through the why, I want to now get into the how. And you know, as I was saying in the very beginning, keep in mind everything I was just talking about there in terms of why integration is occurring, because when we are getting into the how, you know, how we're going to integrate care, we want to make sure that we're integrating in such a way that we are not replicating all these barriers and obstacles that are, you know, that are driving the need for integration in the first place, right? We want to do care a little bit different. So how do we do that? Well, there have been various approaches to integrating behavioral health into primary care that have emerged over the years. Integration has been a movement that's been going on for probably, you know, a few decades, 30 years or so, at least. And so we've learned some things, still a lot that we haven't figured out, but we've learned some things over the years. So we're going to go just briefly through a few different approaches that have been tried as far as, and that are being tried as far as how to integrate behavioral health into primary care. These are called a co-located therapy approach, the collaborative care model, and the primary care behavioral health model. All right. Now, there have been other approaches to integration. You might be familiar with something called ESPERT or medication-assisted therapy. These are kind of, you know, condition-specific efforts to improve care in primary care. But I'm mostly going to be focusing on those top three. I should say there are also an awful lot of places out there that fall into this others category, right, where they're not necessarily doing any of these models clearly that I've just identified here. They're not clearly doing the collaborative care model or the PCBH model or anything else. They're just kind of figuring it out as they go. I would probably, the majority of places are actually in that category. So it can be a little bit messy out there when you look at what's actually going on in the integration world. But there are nonetheless these, you know, these three, you know, somewhat cohesive models and approaches that have emerged. So to talk a little bit more about what I mean by a co-located therapy approach. A co-located therapy approach is basically specialty mental health that is replicated in the primary care clinic. So when people are doing co-located therapy, they'll bring a mental health provider, typically a therapist of some sort, into primary care, and they will work really just the same as they would if they were in a specialty mental health clinic, right? They may kind of have appointments that are kind of rigidly planned. They got their 8 o'clock, their 9 o'clock, their 10 o'clock. They're doing hour-long appointments mostly. They're mostly following the same people, until they are treated successfully. They may be kind of sticking within their comfort zone as far as the kinds of patients they see. There are definitely some advantages to doing this, right? Like if you have a therapist there in the primary care clinic, inevitably, there are going to be some increased opportunities for connecting with patients that otherwise don't get connected with them. They're going to have a little bit more opportunity to collaborate with PCPs. But the problem is that what these people, when they're doing this co-located therapy, what they do is they accidentally kind of bring with them all the barriers that exist out there in the specialty mental health care system. So, for example, it very quickly becomes impossible to get patients in to see them because they have hour-long appointments and they're seeing a lot of the same folks over and over and over again. And so, you know, their appointments just fill up quickly, right? And so, like I was saying earlier, if we're going to try to solve the problem that is leading to integration in the first place, we can't just come into primary care and do the same thing that we were doing on the outside. Because we are just going to be recreating the same access and barrier problems within primary care now. So this co-located therapy approach, it was really particularly representative of early integration attempts. Most systems are now trying to figure out, how can we do something different than this, right? This isn't quite working for us. You know, yeah, it's better than what we had, but we're still not reaching a lot of people that we want to reach, and we can never get people in to see the therapist, you know, when we want, and that sort of a thing. So most places are trying to shift away from a co-located therapy approach. And what are they moving to then? Well, sometimes they're moving toward what's called a collaborative care model. Collaborative care model was developed at the University of Washington, largely. It is a registry-based approach to improving outcomes for anxiety and depression in primary care. Now, sometimes this approach is used for other problems too, diabetes, or starting to get into pediatric problems, but mostly this approach was developed to focus on improving the outcomes for anxiety and depression in primary care. So in this approach, there is a care manager. Often it's a nurse, or it might be a person with behavioral health, more especially behavioral health kind of background, who is tracking the care of patients in a registry, which is basically kind of a glorified Excel spreadsheet, you know, where it tracks all of the patients with anxiety and depression and so forth. And this care manager is following these patients all the way until they are quote unquote treated to target, which means maybe their PHQ drops below a 5 or something like that, right? So they're following them all the way until they're better. And there's typically a psychiatrist who is involved with providing oversight of the care manager. And, you know, looking for, the psychiatrist is looking for medical or medication kinds of, you know, interventions that maybe would be good to do that maybe the PCP, you know, hadn't done yet for whatever reason. And so so this care manager with the psychiatry oversight are following these patients. If they don't come in for an appointment as planned, the care manager will get on the phone with them and try and, you know, get them back in to stay on track with their care and so forth. So this is an approach that has a very robust evidence base, or something like 79 randomized controlled trials that show that if you apply this model with patients with anxiety and depression, they're going to have better outcomes compared to primary care as usual. There's some new CPT codes that have come out that allow for a payment for doing this kind of work. So definite advantages to this approach. The limitations to this approach are that there is just a limited capacity, right? As I was just talking about in the earlier slides, people show up in primary care with all sorts of behavioral challenges. It's behavior that's interfering with their management of their diabetes, you know, it's bereavement, and so on and so forth. And it's not just, you know, anxiety and depression. And so sometimes there are challenges around, hey, this is good. We love this collaborative care model for the problems that it's intended for, but we still got a lot of other patients with a lot of other needs. You know, I got this 8-year-old who's obese, and I'm having trouble getting them, you know, getting any lifestyle changes made in the patient or the family there to get weight back under control, you know, that sort of a thing. That's not the kind of thing that someone in a collaborative care model would work with. Okay, so then the third approach, and again, the one that we're going to be focusing on for the rest of our time today, is called the primary care or PCBH model. So this is, as just an overview, this is a team-based approach, a team-based primary care approach to managing behavioral health conditions. It adds a behavioral health consultant or BHC to the team. And the goal is to enhance the primary care team's ability to manage and treat such conditions with resulting improvements in primary care for the entire population. I'm going to talk a little bit more in a minute about what I mean by that. But suffice to say for now, this is a model that has been widely implemented. It's what we're doing in the DOD, different divisions of the VA, untold numbers of community health centers, and increasingly in the fee-for-service sector too, this model is being implemented. So it's being widely implemented. It's really structured to be in a way that it fits nicely into the PCMH team. The challenges are no follow-up tracking, right? So I was just talking about how in the collaborative care model, they follow up with patients. If they don't show up for a planned appointment, someone is tracking that in a registry. They'll notice that. They'll call the patient, try to get them back in. That's not part of what we do in the PCBH model. So people can be lost kind of to follow up some time, which is a problem. And I would argue too, we need more rigorous data. I mean, we do have some, decent data out there, I think, for this model. But in my opinion, anyway, I'd like to see more rigorous data. So a lot of times, actually, the two models, the collaborative care model and the primary care behavioral health model, are really used together in a very complementary fashion. Again, that's what we're doing in the DOD. It's what I've always done in my systems that I was running as well, using the two hand in hand, because they each kind of fill a niche that the other one doesn't have. In the PCBH model, we're working with patients who have any sort of behavioral health presentation. In the collaborative care model, they're working only with a few discrete conditions. But in the collaborative care model, they track patients, make sure they don't lose them to follow-up. In the PCBH model, we don't do that. So again, there are these complementary functions that can make them good to use together. So I mentioned that the goal of this PCBH model is to improve primary care broadly. What do I mean by that, and why do I say that? Well, what I mean is that we know that primary care has incredibly high value if it's done well, right? So countries that have the most robust primary care systems have the best health outcomes. The U.S. isn't one of them, by the way, unfortunately, but these systems have the best health outcomes. They have the fewest healthcare disparities. They have the lowest healthcare costs. If you really do primary care right, it's incredibly valuable. The problem is, all of the behavioral issues that patients bring with them into primary care really kind of throws a wrench in the works a lot of times. All right, and I don't mean this to be in the slightest, critical of patients who are presenting with behavioral issues. I want more patients to talk about their behavioral issues and present with them in primary care so we can identify them. But it is nonetheless the case that the primary care system kind of wasn't built for that. And so we know that when patients have, when they come in for treatment specifically of a mental health problem like depression or anxiety, those visits last longer than an acute medical visit. And if that depression, anxiety, or whatever it is, gets identified spontaneously during a visit, the visits last, even longer than that. And then that kind of has this ripple effect where now the PCP is really far behind, and how do they make up, their time? They may have to steal time from other visits, that kind of a thing. It can be stressful, even when patients are not presenting for a specific condition, just the behaviors people bring with them, right? Just some people talk very slow, and man, is it a long time to get through a visit with those patients, right? Or other patients, they show up 20 minutes late and demand to be seen, still. And this causes a problem then with the front desk and again, a ripple effect throughout the clinic. So the behavioral issues that patients bring with them, you know, you can really argue kind of hinder primary care's ability to reach its potential. So what we're trying to do here, we're just trying to be a resource to the whole primary care team to help them to better manage whatever behavioral issues patients are bringing into the clinic with them, okay? So what are just some quick examples of how we can do that? Well, you know, if I'm working as a BHC, I might see a patient before the PCP to help cut down the visit time that the PCP needs with that patient, right? If I know they're coming in for depression, maybe I can work them in, see them, you know, maybe the PCP's already 30 minutes behind. If I can jump in and see that patient get started on their depression visit, that's going to potentially save the PCP a lot of time then when they see the patient, you know, right after me. Because we can talk about, you know, what's going on with the patient, what are they struggling with, what's going well, what do they think they need today, that kind of a thing that can really help the PCP to shorten their visit time a lot. Sometimes seeing patients instead of the PCP, which, you know, helps improve the access to the PCP for other patients. Maybe completing certain activities that consume PCP time, like cognitive screens and Medicare wellness exams, or in a couple of systems I've been in before, the BHCs would regularly go in and do the anticipatory guidance during well child checks so that the we would cover all the anticipatory guidance items, and the PCP didn't have to take as much time when she or he was in there because all that had already been done. Assisting with miscellaneous care needs. So when patients come in and they, you know, want a letter for an emotional support animal, or they've got paperwork for their disability for PTSD that they want their PCP to fill out, and, you know, it's 8 pages long, maybe that's something that can just be handed off to the behavioral health team member that can take that load off of the PCP. Sometimes co-leading group medical visits to help with a number of different things. So the point here is that, you know, when in this model, we're not just trying to think about how do we get, you know, the best care possible to the individual patient that's referred to us as BHCs, but we're also trying to think about how do we help the clinic and the system just to function better in general. You know, what burdens can we lift here that can free up primary care as much as possible to do the work that they need to do, right? So the basic components of this PCBH model are that when these behavioral health consultants are in primary care, they're functioning in ways that meet the GATHER acronym, all right? So in the word GATHER here, the G stands for generalist. So that means that the behavioral health consultant sees patients with any sort of behavioral health concern, any age, they're a generalist. Whatever walks in the door, they're there to help with. The A means they're highly accessible, right? So it means that they aim to see patients on the same day that a problem is identified by the PCP. There's no kind of write a paper referral, come back to see me next week. It's no, we're gonna do a warm handoff, work you in today, get some care going for you today. T means team-based, where we are, as BHCs, we're benefiting from being on the team. We're often working out of exam rooms. We're using the same medical record that the PCPs are using. We're using the same scheduling desk that the PCPs are using, but we're also giving back to the team and looking for ways to take work off of their plates, like I was mentioning before. The H means high productivity. So as a BHC, I'm anticipating seeing a lot more patients on a given day than I might if I was in a specialty mental health care clinic. The E stands for educator. It means part of the BHC role, behavioral health consultant role, is to help the whole primary care team just to feel more confident, more competent when working with behavioral issues. We try and operate in a number of different ways in order to make that happen. We might do briefings, lunch and learns, you know, presentations during staff meetings, things like that, just, you know, about behavioral topics to help boost the overall confidence and competence of the team for working with behavioral issues. And then the R means routine. we want, when a behavioral health consultant is gets engaged with the patient, we want that to feel to the patient like just a regular part of their healthcare, not like something kind of strange and different that, you know, is going to potentially generate a lot of stigma around it, right? But we want it to feel like, wow, seeing this behavioral health person just kind of feels like an extension of my visit with my family doctor today. So in order to do this, BHCs work a little bit different than they would if they were in specialty mental health. They have 30-minute visits on their template instead of 60. That's just a starting point. Sometimes when you're working people in, you might only take 15 minutes with them, right? Depending on how things go. But your template starts with 30-minute visits. And then you utilize a consultant follow-up structure. So instead of following up with patients like a therapist would, where you're following them all the way until they are better, which is a practice that, you know, again, can lead to some of those access problems, right? If you're seeing people back over and over and over again, it's hard for new people to get in to see you. Instead, we're following up like a consultant would. So remember, you're part of a team that's caring for this patient. It's not you alone who's doing it. So you are following up along with the PCP until the some positive change is occurring, the patient's going in a better direction, they got a good plan in place for keeping that change going. At that point, they're going to back out of the planned follow-up, and the PCP, of course, will just continue to follow the patient. You can always, as a BHC, be brought back into care as needed when new problems come up or other ones emerge, but you back out of the planned follow-up at that point. Okay. So in order to kind of put some meat on the bones with this, I want to go through a day in the life of a BHC. So I'm going to walk you through here an actual day, a clinic day from my clinic. And we'll just kind of go through, you know, the 9 o'clock appointment, 9:30 and so on and so forth. And as I go through this, there are a few things I want you to watch for. One is, you know, how were the patients getting to me? What are the different types of problems I was seeing patients for? And the different goals in my visit, okay? Sometimes the visits are about getting direct care to the patient. Sometimes it's just about helping the PCP with some sort of management aspect, of care management aspect for that patient, okay? I think you'll see what I mean as we go through the day here in a minute. But just for a little context, so this is the clinic where this day in the life occurred. It was a community health center, probably not unlike a lot of the health centers that all of you work in. Community health center just outside of Seattle. This was the provider pod. My desk was the one on the end here. And right next to me was the pediatrician. Right next to her was her MA. The nurse was also in there. It's a very important part, by the way, of doing integrated care, is making your behavioral health consultant very easily accessible to the PCPs and the team. This is just the other side of that provider pod where we had other PCPs, nurses, MAs sitting. So again, very easily accessible. The office where I saw patients, you can see it in the foreground here. This was the behavioral health office, and it was right in the middle of all the exam rooms, right? So all these other rooms here, that room where the woman in pink is, that's that provider pod I just showed you a minute ago. And then I'm otherwise surrounded by all exam rooms. Now, sometimes I should say, you know, some places use this dedicated office model for their BHC, like I'm describing here, but it's also probably the optimal way to function as a BHC is to actually not have an office, right? And I've done this before too. I actually love this way of working. You don't have a behavioral health office, but you have an exam room that is designated to you on a given day. So, and it's going to be a different exam room each day, right? So not all clinics have the space to do this, the exam room availability to do this, but when they do, it can work out great. So for example, on Monday, I might be assigned to exam room 2. On Tuesday, I might be assigned to exam room 10. And so I'm spreading myself around the clinic. And when I'm seeing patients, I'm working out of these exam rooms. When I'm not seeing patients, I'm in those provider pods that I mentioned to you earlier. And then sometimes people just have, rather than a shared exam room like that, or rather than a specific behavioral health office, they'll have a dedicated exam room where they're assigned to, for example, exam room 3 all day long every day. That's just their spot for seeing patients. So some clinics do it that way too. But in this particular clinic, we were using a behavioral health office. Now, again, couldn't get the videos to quite work. I apologize, but this is a video that if you watch it later, it'll just show a warm handoff occurring between a pediatrician and a behavioral health consultant. Let me see if I can get it. Let me try it one more time here. I'm gonna hit play here, and then if one of you could type in the chat box if you can hear it or not, and if it's actually working, let me give it a try here. Oops. Sorry about that. I think I accidentally touched the button. Could you see the video and could you hear anything?
Yes.
Okay, great. You might need to turn up your volume, by the way, too. It's very low volume on the video. Okay, great. Well, let's go ahead and do it then. So you're gonna see a pediatrician coming out of the room on the right. She's gonna interrupt a behavioral health consultant in the room on the left, in the foreground. And she's going to ask her to see this kiddo that has been having trouble with encapresis, all right? So this is kind of a typical warm handoff. And you'll see as I go through my day in the life, I do a lot of these. This is what an example of what that can look like. Okay, yeah, I heard can't hear them speaking. Yeah, there's a problem with the volume. Okay, so, well, even if you couldn't hear the exact words, you kind of get a sense for the flow, right? And when when we do warm handoffs, that's what I'm talking about in terms of the amount of time that it takes, you know, the basic workflow. There's a quick interaction between the PCP and the BHC where it gets explained what the concern is that they'd like the help with. Go in, even if you're in the middle of a patient visit as a BHC, you're going in, meeting the patient, arranging to see them a little bit later. That's a warm handoff, okay? Apologize for the video quality there, but hopefully you got at least those basic takeaways there. Okay, so let's go through, I already went through this slide earlier, just things to look for as I go through the day here. keeping in mind that when you see a warm handoff on here, that's kind of sort of what it means. Okay, so on this particular day, I started with a 9 o'clock patient who was a 52-year-old gentleman. He was homeless, and the PCP wanted some help figuring out what medication to start with, right? He was very agitated. The PCP didn't know, is he anxious, is he manic, does he have ADHD? So my goal with that visit was just to jump in and try to figure out where we might start, medication-wise. 9:30, I wasn't recommending a medication, but kind of figuring out the diagnostic piece of it there. 9:30 was a 64-year-old woman, a Russian speaker. Again, this was community health, lots of interpreters. She had a question about her disability expiring, right? She had depression, disability from that. Wanted my help figuring out kind of, you know, paperwork related to that. 10 o'clock was a 62-year-old PCP said, I really don't know where to even start. She's a new patient to me. She's on 3 different psychotropic meds from 3 different doctors. Can you help me figure out just a game plan for getting started here? Okay. 10:30 was initially an open appointment on my schedule that led to a warm handoff. That's WH, warm handoff, with the PCP in the exam room. So the PCP in this case saw me sitting there in the pod, saw that I wasn't doing anything, you know, wasn't seeing a patient, and said, hey, I've got this 12-year-old, I've seen him back for autism, ADHD, I've been treating him with stimulants. He recently started showing some tics and hallucinations. I'd love if you'd come in with me and we'll just see him together and kind of put our heads together about what's going on here, right? What are we gonna do for this kid? 11 o'clock was, NS stands for no show. So 11 o'clock was a no show. And that led to another warm handoff where, again, the PCP saw me in the pod, saw that I wasn't seeing a patient, said, hey, I've got this, I'm running like 45 minutes behind here. It's the end of the morning. I'm way behind. I've got a 6-year-old who's come back to see me for ADHD, insomnia, and uresis. If you could go in there and get started with him and find out how things are going, what we maybe need to be doing today to keep things moving in the right direction, that'd be fantastic. So I did that. I went in, saw that 11 o'clock, and then circled back with that provider. And, you know, we talked through where things were with the patient, and then they went in and saw the patient and, you know, consequently were able to see that patient in a lot less time and get a little bit of time for lunch there. 11:30 was a planned follow-up from 1 week earlier, a 20-year-old Spanish speaker who had been depressed with suicidal ideation. So I was kind of trying to keep some close tabs on her. 12 o'clock was lunch. 1 o'clock was a team meeting where, again, part of that, if you go back to that GATHER acronym that I mentioned, the E is that we try to be educators for the team because they don't get, most members of the primary care team don't get a whole lot of education about how to work with behavior issues. So we try to do little talks and briefings as we can with them. So on this particular day, I talked for 15 minutes at a staff meeting about chronic pain and 5 minutes about tobacco cessation. 2 o'clock was patient who canceled. But then another patient walked in to the front desk, said, I need to get a refill of my patches. That's NRT, nicotine replacement therapy. And in our clinic, the BHCs were the ones who were handing out the nicotine patches to patients once the PCP had approved it, because they're over-the-counter things. So the front desk said, oh, great, Dr. Ryder can see you right now. They put him on my schedule for 2 o'clock. I worked him in, did some tobacco cessation, and got him his patches. 2:30 was initially an open appointment that led to a warm handoff for where I filled out a controlled substance agreement with the patient. So this was a 60-year-old who had chronic pain and had a history of alcohol problems, but the PCP had him on opiates and wanted to make sure that he was understanding, you know, all the expectations and rules around taking opiates. So in our clinic, the behavioral health provider was the one who would do those controlled substance agreements, those medication agreements with patients. 3 o'clock was a planned follow-up after 2 weeks, 3 o'clock and 3:30 actually was a couple. Had a kind of a mix of some clinical needs. They were both homeless, living in a car. I had a mix of some clinical needs and some case management that I was helping with. 4 o'clock was a patient who had canceled. That led to a warm handoff for what we call PCP prep. So again, it's just helping prep for the PCP's appointment with the patient. This was a 16-year-old who had been expelled from school, and the school had said, hey, before you come back to school here, you got to show us that you're not going to be a risk. And so that patient had just come in to see PCP to get that risk assessment done. So they asked me if I could go in and figure out what we need to do to help out and get things going. 4:30 was initially an open appointment on my schedule, and that led to a same-day follow-up of a patient who had called in that day, somebody I had seen before, was on disability for PTSD and depression and wanted to come follow up with me to take care of some needs, okay? So that is the basics. I've got 2 more slides here I wanna go through. I'm gonna blow through these. I know it's not gonna leave us much of any time for discussion, but let's see, I've got 1 question here. I'm wondering if the planned follow-ups would be generally in person by phone. Both. Okay. Could be either one. Most of them were in person, but I've done lots of visits, over the phone as well. Definitely a place for that. I'm going to come back to the ways of paying for these services. I got a question about that because it's kind of a very large question. I'm kind of outside of the model, I guess, itself. But let me come back to that if I do have time here. Let me blow through these next couple slides here so I'm done with this content, because I do want to make sure we cover a little bit of the landmines and the trampolines, right? When we're thinking about how to do this kind of work, like I was saying earlier, there are things that you can do that can really help grow this service, things that you can do that really work against growing it. One of those things that can help to really interfere with growth is if you have an isolated BHC. If you stick the BHC off in the quiet admin wing of the clinic, or you got to go through two locked doors to get to them, or what have you. You saw how I was visible and central to everybody in that provider pod. That's a crucial trampoline, okay? A second landmine is to have a passive approach as a BHC. What I mean by that is so often, in especially mental health, we take kind of a passive approach with patients. We say, okay, you're going to be coming to see me for a long time here. We don't need to figure it all out. Today, we're just going to do the intake, then come back in a couple of weeks. We'll get started on the therapy. We'll talk through our goals, right? Instead, you need to do in primary care, do today's work today. All right. So when patients are there to see you, you're not just doing an intake and gathering information on that first visit. You are jumping in, doing an intervention, right? We know that most patients are only going to see you for one visit. And that's true whether it's especially mental health or primary care. So you want to do today's work today. Triaging and referring is another landmine. What this means is, if as a behavioral health consultant, you see a patient, you think, oh man, this patient's way too complicated for me in primary care here. I got 30 minutes. What can I do? I'm not going to do anything with them. I'm just going to refer them out and try and convince them to go to special mental health. Well, more often than not, you can try that. They're probably not going to go. All right. And so you're going to end up having squandered an opportunity to work with them if you do that. So instead, have a little faith that maybe you can do something in primary care, because in fact, you can do a lot in primary care. It's not just you, it's the whole team there that can help. So jump in, try to help no matter what's going on with the patient. A fourth landmine is an inefficient warm handoff process. You saw how little time that warm handoff took in that video. If instead you have warm handoffs that take a lot of PCP time, really bog them down, they're not going to do warm handoffs, right? You have to be really efficient in that process, so that it's very, very easy for the PCP to take a bit of extra time to come involve you, and for the patient to stay to see you too. A fifth landmine is just doing what we call meet and greets, where you get a warm handoff and you say, oh, geez, I only have 15 minutes today before my next patient. So I'm just gonna introduce myself to you, give you my business card, have you come back next week to see me. Guess what? Patients often don't come back, right? So instead, it's important to flex your visit length, jump in, do something to help that day, no matter what it may be, and get the care going. Because again, that may be your only opportunity. Okay. And then last few landmines and trampolines here. One landmine, overemphasizing BHC interventions, right? Versus looking at ways to help the primary care provider and team. The more that you can help the primary care team to do their work better and take work off of their plates, that's where you're getting a huge bang for the buck. If you're solely focused on how do I as a BHC have the best interventions possible with my individual patients, well, you're never going to see as many patients as the PCP will. Okay, so you will get a much bigger bang for the buck if you find ways to help the PCPs to work more efficiently and effectively. But a lot of times we lose focus on that as BHCs. Limiting problem scope. Again, this is something that's commonly done in the specialty care world. We don't want to do it in primary care. We want to be a generalist. Don't want to limit the number of visits that you see patients. Be a consultant, right? Just, think longitudinally, right? So you don't need to say, oh, it's my fourth visit. You're not improving. I'm not going to see you anymore. But instead, remember, your goal is to follow patients until they are starting to improve, got a clear plan in place for improving, then you can back out of the planned care. And sometimes that takes a little bit longer for folks. Treat diseases versus teaching skills. What I mean by this is, if you look at a patient when they walk in to see you and you say, oh, what do you see? You see borderline personality disorder printed on their forehead, or chronic alcohol dependence printed on their forehead, your first impulse is going to think, what can I possibly do for this person, right? You're not going to want to engage at all. Instead, if you're thinking about, okay, let's cast the diagnosis aside here. What kind of skills does this person need to really function optimally? Maybe instead of labeling them with a diagnosis here, maybe I can identify that they need some assistance with learning how to manage their anger, right? Or learning how to sleep better. Well, now these are skills that I can work with people on, right? But if you've got that kind of disease-focused mentality, you're gonna frequently feel helpless, especially with briefer visits, right? And lastly, having low expectations for the BHC, right? A lot of clinics where PCBH services are not functioning well, they kind of consider that service to be what I call a nicety. Yeah, it's nice to have it. Yeah, what's that BHC's name again? I don't know. I don't really remember. Yeah, it's great. You know, she handles my, emergencies when they pop up. That's a nicety. That's the kind of service that's gone in a heartbeat when there's a budget issue. Instead, you want your service to be a necessity. You want primary care providers, when they're asked about you, to say, oh my goodness, you know, Phyllis, she is an amazing asset to my team. I don't know how I ever practice without her. I tell her, you can't take vacation unless I'm taking vacation too, right? That's a necessity, and that's what you want to get to. So with that, just remember the goal of making primary care better and thinking like a primary care team member. And I got a question slide here, but I know we're at 10:02. And so I'm happy to stay a little bit longer, but I know a lot of you probably can't. So hopefully that was helpful, despite the time crunch. And as far as the various ways of paying for these services, Braden, there are lots. I mean, we use all the regular billing code, 90791, 90832, health and behavior codes. It just really depends a lot on the credentials of your behavioral health consultants and the rules in your state and with your payers. But I've always used just the same billing codes that anyone else uses.
Have you noticed any difficulty using the 90832 or the 90791?
No.
Okay.
No, I haven't.
Jeff, Peter Jensen here. That was a great presentation. It would be helpful if you could prepare just another little summary of, those three codes, when you use them and why, and what the limitations might be by state. You know, it'd be hard to do it by state because there'll be differences, or by insurance company, et cetera. But that would be useful.
Yeah, right, absolutely. Well, yeah, the 90832 or the 90791, keep in mind, that one is not time-based, right? A lot of people think it is, but it's not. It's not time-based. So I've used 90791 for initial visits with patients that were 20 minutes long, as long as I was doing what I felt was a comprehensive enough assessment and so forth. The 90832 is 30-minute interventions, but remember that's rounded, okay? It doesn't have to be exactly 30 minutes, so there are many visits that are shorter than that you can very legitimately get paid for. The health and behavior codes, those are, it's a lot more picky about who can, with most payers, about who gets reimbursed for those. But, those are billed in 15-minute units. And again, those are, with the new changes, I think as of January 1 this year, I think they changed the rules a little bit. I forget them exactly. I think it's maybe 30-minute visits now. But it's still rounded. So if you spend more than 15 minutes with somebody, you can bill for one unit of a health and behavior code. So a lot of these codes have a lot more flexibility in them than people think, and it's totally, totally okay. I've worked with insurance companies on all of this. There's a There are really good consulting companies out there that can work with you as well on this aspect. Let's see, how do you handle co-insurance and co-pays? Yeah, I mean, typically what we would do is, like, for warm handoffs, we would make sure that people know that we're going to be billing their insurance. That's part of our standard introduction of ourselves that we would do with patients. Make sure that they know that these services are billed. And then, but we wouldn't typically collect the copay, you know, before the patient was seen for the warm handoff. That just becomes a problem with the workflow a lot of times, but we would bill the patients later for it. And, you know, I can tell you, I initially for many years worked in a community health center where we had lots of grant funding and we weren't billing at all for these visits. And then I shifted into the fee-for-service sector, partly because I was curious about how do you make this work in a system where you got to account for every nickel that you spend, you know? And I was, you know, so we started billing and I was really nervous that how's this going to work? Are patients going to refuse to see us? Are they going to complain when they get the bill? It was one of the biggest kind of surprises of my integrated care life about how little problem we had billing. And so again, that really depends a lot on the, you know, the insurance mix, right? If you've got a high Medicaid population and they don't maybe have copays, they don't have a lot of expenses out of pocket, you know, it becomes a lot easier versus some private insurances, you know, can be more problematic. But let's see, Peter Jensen, what issues related to a BHC being employed by the practice versus being an independent provider that is doing all their own billing? Well, I think it mostly comes down to probably, availability. I mean, I don't know, most private practitioners that I know, they take a whole, if they're full-time in their private practice, they take a whole day each week to do their paperwork. You know, I mean, it is really burdensome. And so that's just, you know, time that you are out of clinic there. And so the more that you can be integrated more seamlessly into just all of the workings of the primary care clinic, the better. But obviously there are lots of practical barriers that make that more or less difficult for people, you know.
Hey, Jeff.
You point out that the BHC should ideally try to follow all patients, but when do you find you have to refer and how often does that happen? Okay, excellent question. Yeah. So the general rule is that I encourage people, unless it's an emergency or the PCP has said, you know, I need specialty care involved with this patient, or unless the patient, him or herself, requests it, unless you have those circumstances, jump in as a BHC together with the rest of the team trying to work with this patient. Give it a chance, right? Patients will sometimes surprise you. Even complex chronic patients can make some really nice changes, you know, out of nowhere sometimes, right? So jump in, try to help. If you follow them though for a few visits and they're going nowhere fast, that's when you would try to engage them with the specialty mental health care system, right? It's kind of like what happened when I went in to see my PCP with a rash. You know, I had a rash. Sorry if that's TMI, but had a rash on my foot. It was my foot. And, you know, the PCP said, well, I don't know exactly what that is or exactly where we're going to start here, but try this antifungal cream. It looks like that might be something that's going to respond to that. And come back if that's not working, right? So I tried the antifungal. Didn't work. Went back to the PCP. The PCP said, well, let's try the steroid cream. Let's see, because a lot of times that'll knock out stuff that the other cream doesn't. Tried the steroid cream, that didn't work. The PCP said, okay, you know what? I've done what I can do here in primary care. I've tried to help, but you're a tough one. It's not improving. Let's have you go to the dermatologist. Okay. So that's kind of the same model that we're using too. And you know, if patients do, if they go, that's great. If they don't, we're going to continue to follow them though. This is not an either or thing, you know, it's not like either you're seen in specialty mental health or we're seeing you in primary care. Primary care is that constant care in the background for everyone, right? It's just that we're going to try to also engage patients in specialty care at times, especially if they're not benefiting from what we're doing. Patty asks, have you found that PCP practices might pay some fee for all the extra non-billable activities or does it work out? Do you mean... Can you elaborate on what you mean by that?
Yeah, like you mentioned, a lot of the most useful things were those just chatting with the PCPs about how they might manage something, doing trainings during lunch, or facilitating, you know, maybe doing that prep visit or paperwork or something that might not really fit into a billable encounter. Or do you manage to make all those things billable?
Yeah, that those unfortunately typically become just kind of unpaid time, you know, just like it is for PCPs. And there's so much of that in the healthcare system, right? Where we all know as clinicians that, geez, we're doing all this stuff that's so valuable and we don't get paid for it. but yeah, I mean, I've not seen too many places that are, or any place that I can think of that's reimbursing for that kind of thing, unfortunately. Braden, I love your question. Thank you for that. Because please don't have that rule there. Your question is, I worked in a PCBH model when we were asked to not see patients more than 4 to 6 times. Does this make sense or is this a poor approach? Not only is it not a poor approach, it's not the PCBH model, all right? So this is a common misconception that people have out there. And if you go back to one of my earlier slides here, like, you know, one of the landmines here, mm-hmm. the third one down is limiting the number of visits, right? People think that this is a, oftentimes they unfortunately think that this PCBH model is a, you know, a brief therapy approach, that we're gonna treat you for 3 to 4 visits. If you're not improving, then can't do anything more for you, right? And draw the line there, okay? It's not, you're a part of a team here, okay? And you're in primary care, so you never disengage from patients. It's not a question of, am I gonna be helping them or is somebody else gonna be helping them? Generally speaking, like I was saying a minute ago, if you've seen a patient for a few times and they're not improving, then yeah, just like the PCP did with my rash, refer me out to a specialist, you know, and try to get a specialist involved. But what we know is so often those patients won't go or they can't go to the specialist or what have you, but they're gonna keep coming into primary care anyway. So you need to stay involved with them, right? You're a member of the team who's trying to help this patient over time. So, you know, I've had patients who I've seen, I was in the same clinic for about 13 years. I've had some patients I saw probably hundreds of times, you know, scores of times, hundreds of times. But it wasn't like I sat down with them in the beginning and said, I need to see you for 150 visits over the next 10 years. Let's plan this out, right? It was just, you know, it was just that it worked out that way, right? I saw them for a couple of years, a few visits there as problems came up. This is how primary care works, okay? So thank you for that question. And yes, probably another day question there, Patty, about the great question about how do you measure satisfaction. Suffice to say that's extremely important to do. There's no standard way to do it, but it's a really important thing to do. I've always done it, you know, at least annually, if not a couple times a year, as part of our program evaluation. Optimal training tape, a couple more questions, and then I better run. Got to get to my regular day job here, but how does one obtain optimal training to be a BAC? Well, another good question. You know, there are certainly books and resources out there that are available about practicing in the PCBH model. There is no one training system, unfortunately, about how to be a BAC. There are consultants, you know, this is kind of one of the things I do is I help train people through my consulting company. There are other consulting companies that do that too. There are conferences you can go to. CFHA, the Collaborative Family Health Association that Patty mentioned earlier at the top of our talk, can, you know, has some good PCBH related activities in it. Actually, they have a lot of good PCBH activities. So if you're not a member of CFHA, yes, I'm a member of the board, but I don't get any kickback if you join CFHA. So I can advocate for it. That's a great organization to be a part of. Do my books cover reimbursement info? Not much. There's a good book by, I think I saw you having Kent Corso come and talk to you all in a subsequent talk. He and a woman named Leslie Manson, M-A-N-S-O-N, they wrote, and a couple other people I think, wrote a book recently that details the financial ins and outs of getting started in integrated care. And the name of the book is escaping me, but I'm pretty sure Kent will know the topic or the title. So ask him when he's on. And Leslie Manson is another person who you might want to consider having come talk to you. Or actually, I've got their card right here, Brown Consulting Associates. They're out of Idaho. They are excellent. They are really, really good. And they are all about helping people understand how to bill in integrated care. And I've not worked with them directly, but I grabbed their card at a conference because I've seen them at a few conferences and they give really, really good talks. So, you know, unfortunately, it's kind of just about finding resources out there and piecemealing it to figure out how do you get one of these services started and how do you learn how to do it. So, wish I had a better answer than that.
We know you have to go to your regular job. We appreciate you taking the time today. This has been an amazing talk. I have learned so much. It's always a pleasure to hear from you. We had lots of questions, and we hope to be moving ahead in Arkansas. This is fairly new, but this is so helpful to us. A lot of people on the call are actually doing this work. And so I'm sure this answered a lot of their questions. Dr. Gibson, would you like to have any closing comments?
No, I was just going to say that it has been very helpful and given us some good takeaways for today in terms of how to actually do it. I loved hearing the actual what a day in the life, and then some of the landmines and trampolines were great, like speaking as a clinician, but then also giving us the science. It's been really useful. We have some people involved on the line that are in the management of some of our CPC Plus and getting their support and providing some more opportunities for training. So this has been really helpful, and it's what we need, picking up pieces along the way. And Jeff, I think people may not realize that you really are one of our national premier experts in behavioral health integration. And it's very humbling and awesome that you've been able to give us your time. And it speaks to the passion that people who are doing behavioral health integration, that we're trying to change healthcare. And I see you giving of yourself, not only to this hour, but in other presentations that you've done. And it really means a lot. And we appreciate that.
Oh, well, thanks. Those are very kind comments. I really appreciate that. And yeah, there's a lot of people who are very giving of their time, including, I'm guessing, all of you. But thanks. I appreciate that. Yeah. Well, thanks, everybody. You've been a great audience. Sorry that I ended up kind of rushed there, but, you know, you got the slides. And all the best to you.
Yeah. We appreciate it. Thank you again.
Okay, thank take you. Care. Bye-bye. Yeah, thanks. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
That was great. Thank you so much.
He's also, I don't know whether to call him a founder, but he worked very closely with Patty Robinson and Kirk Strassel and the ACT model, but, you know, really